في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين، فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. Last Friday we focused on the ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Today I have completed your deen for you and I have perfected my bounties upon you and I am pleased to have you take Islam as your faith. And we explained that the completion of the faith means that nothing is missing to look for it, nothing is lost to substitute for it, and nothing is changed to look for fixing it. It is complete and it is perfect. The overall topic we are covering is about understanding Islam and some of the misunderstandings we have about Islam. Last time also we mentioned how far Islam goes to mention and attend to issues that happen very far away from where the Muslims used to be. At the time the Quran was being revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muslims were in basically Mecca and Medina. That's all what was. And they were at least a month to go north of Arabia and a month to go down to Yemen. And despite that, the Quran mentions that the tug of war between Persia and Russia is something important for Muslims to pay attention to. And we explain the circumstances of this. Today I want to move to another issue also under the topic of understanding and misunderstanding Islam. Lately we started to hear some of the so-called liberal and secular Muslims, especially Muslim personalities in the media, in some if not many Muslim countries, questioning what does Allah have to do with politics? What does Allah have to do with governance? What does Islam as a deen have to do with political issues, public affairs issues? Pushing to corner the deen only at home or in the masjid. And in one country in particular, that is Egypt, the masjids have been so many of them closed that the deen is now only at home if you want to have it. The curricula of Islamic studies has been removed and substituted with ethics and morality issues, as if Islam would not cover it. So they want us to listen to Western philosophers and Eastern philosophers about ethics as if we don't have a deen that teaches ethics. But I'm not going to zoom in or focus on Egypt or anything like that. I just wanted to pick it as a ready example that is in my head. But this is exactly true in many other Arab and Muslim nations. Islam is being squeezed out of the souls of people, out of the society, out of governance, out of the army, out of the police, out of the media, out of the courts, that now it happened what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about Islam, بدأ الإسلام غريبا وسيعود غريبا كما بدأ. Islam started as a strange religion. Muslims were lonely people, few of them in Mecca. For 3 years, only 63 people accepted Islam with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, trying to survive severe torture severe intimidation and killing and their money taken away, their families breaking down. They tried to survive all of the discrimination and persecution that they face. But that is not only true for Muslims. People who followed Isa also were persecuted. Every community that followed a prophet were persecuted from Nuh down. Every community, that is not strange. But what is strange in our situation is that this persecution is done both in the name of moderate Islam, the Western acceptable Islam, in the name of Allah, and on the hands of so-called Muslims, modern Muslims, whether they are rulers or helpers of the rulers or Pharaoh's magicians or anybody else. But the attack and the campaign is to corner Muslims, to make them feel alienated and unwanted and unacceptable, so that Muslims would start to give up. But alhamdulillah, what we see is that maybe the old generation is intimidated, but the youth is not. And they will never be intimidated. The youth are the people who stood up with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he says himself, نصرني الشباب وخزلني الشيوخ. Youth have supported me and the elders have let me down. That is exactly the case. Any cause between truth and falsehood is always supported by youth, because they are able to take risks. They have less to fear for and much to lose if they don't fight back against oppression and against persecution and against the campaign of intimidation. What is this battle really centering around? It is centering around one thing and one thing only. لَنُخْرِجَنَّكَ يَا شُعَيْبُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَكَ مِنْ قَرْيَتِنَا أَوْ لَتَعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. O Shu'aib, his people told him, those who disbelieved, they told him, Shu'aib, listen, either that we will kick you out, you and your followers, out of our town, or else you must come back and join our religion, join our way of life. قَالَ أَوَلَوْ كُنَّا كَارِهِينَ. He said, do you want us to do this even we don't like it? Yes. They are fighting Muslims and telling Muslims, you should not convert people by force. And they are right to say that. But they want Muslims to change by force their own faith. They don't want Muslim women to dress the hijab. They don't want Muslim children to memorize even the Quran. They don't want the educational system to produce better people, more righteous individuals. They don't want Muslims to work together. They don't want Muslims to live together. They want us to be divided. But it is not their problem. They are doing their bidding. That is their mission. A person who refuses to believe for whatever reason, they have every motive to attack anyone who believes. But don't we have a similar motive to push back? Shouldn't we have a similar, stronger motive to push back and defend ourselves? The answer is yes. Education, teaching our kids Islam, correct Islam, full and complete Islam is the way forward. Not to let them fall prey and victims of misinformation and disinformation and government entrapment. Yes, we have to wake up and live our deen fully. But how could we do this when we don't understand the full spectrum of what Islam really means? Let us go back to the point I raised in the beginning. Does Islam really have a say in public affairs of a nation? Does Islam have a say on educational systems or judiciary or the media? What does Islam have to do with all of this? Well, basically, all of these are instruments of power and instruments of managing the society, of directing its morality and applying the laws that force people to live a life that is peaceful for everybody. Now, in Africa, in Western Africa, where Ebola virus is spreading very badly, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save everybody from that virus and that attack. Nations are using, including our own, the military to force safety. Quarantining people is using force. For what? For their safety. It is like imprisoning a criminal. It is to produce safer society. It is not meant to kill somebody or hurt someone. It is meant to be a deterrent for someone else not to do the same. Likewise, Islamic law is meant to do exactly that. Islamic law is meant as a deterrent so that if a crime is committed and the punishment is applied, this will produce less crimes. It is like the retribution that you do in case of killing. If somebody kills, then the killer is subject to the law, and the law is the killer will be killed if it was deliberate, if it was intentional. So what is the hikmah, what is the wisdom behind it? It is to stop the next killing. That is the purpose. So as much as we are able to relate laws that man makes to peace and safety and less crime and better societies, the same could be also attributed to Islamic law. There is little difference between the intention behind any law. The only difference is who is enacting these laws. In the case of Islam, Allah has instituted certain laws. وَكَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ فِيهَا أَنَّ النَّفْسَ بِالنَّفْسِ وَالْعَيْنَ بِالْعَيْنِ وَالْأَنْفَ بِالْأَنْفِ وَالْأُذُنَ بِالْأُذُنِ وَالسِّنَّ بِالسِّنِّ وَالْجُرُوحَ قِصَاصٌ. This is the law of Allah. An eye for an eye, a nose for a nose, an ear for an ear, and a teeth for a teeth, and all wounds are subject to judicial retribution, so that people do not take each other for granted, and crime would spread. So what is the difference between these punishments and other punishments that man makes on his or her own? Whether it is a society, a group, a legislator, or anybody else. The only difference is some laws come from Allah and some laws come from man. Does this mean that there is no room for man to make any laws? No, it does not. Man can and should be making laws, but not ones that contradict the laws of Allah. Not any law that contradicts the law of Allah. And why is this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created us. That's what we believe as Muslims. And I'm talking to us about us and about our issue with secular and liberal Muslims, okay, who don't want Islam to have any say in public life. And we Muslims want to say Islam manages and guides public life, including the process of legislation itself. It has to be guided by Islamic principles. Let us talk about some of those principles. One of the principles of Islamic legislation is دفع المفسدة مقدم على جلب المصلحة. To terminate, eliminate, or quarantine, or limit mischief or corruption is to be given precedent over doing anything to achieve an objective of improvement. So you put first removal of evil and removal of mischief and corruption. Then you can look for how to improve society. Because with corruption, with evil, with shirk, how could you improve any society no matter what law you put? If the law is not in the hearts of the people, how many soldiers do you have to watch over everybody 24/7? There has to be internal motive. How could secular law produce internal motives? The motive will always be, I am afraid of being caught. I am not concerned about the violation. I am concerned about the punishment. And when I'm not caught, I can do whatever I can. And that's exactly the legal mindset that is nurtured by a law that is not entrenched and anchored in faith in God, faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that becomes a big problem even as far as the issue of safety and peace in the society. But there is a bigger issue. When any community decides that they will ignore the laws of Allah and enact their own, what are they saying? They are saying not only that they have as much right as Allah to legislate, but even better than Him. So they are putting aside what Allah sends down of regulations and rules to live by, and they are instituting their own, which are contrary to the laws of Allah. What are they claiming doing that? Even if their mouth says, I am a Muslim, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, أشهد أن محمد رسول الله, but the actions speak louder than words. When somebody says, you are my teacher, you are my teacher, but every time you speak, they are against you, they are not taking you serious as their teacher. So we have to be careful that our ummah has one thing and one thing only to be ready for improvement of our condition. That is to submit to Allah. And those who want us to follow their rules and their laws and their systems, they want us to be their slaves, not servants of Allah, their own slaves. And nations that try to control its subjects, if it is royalties, or it is citizens, if it is a republic or something other than royalties, then they want everybody in that society to just submit to the system to live. Otherwise, you are either exiled, imprisoned, or killed. The force, the brute force against peoples in the Muslim world is employed today to force people to submit, to break their will. This is done by Muslim governments, much more so than non-Muslim governments. And when I say Muslim, it is just what you know of their Islam. It's only a claim, because you can't be a Muslim when you don't submit to Allah, when you submit to your own desire. Why does the Quran mention the story of Pharaoh? Because Pharaoh was honest with himself and with his community. He spoke it as he did it. He said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. You live by my rules, and I am your higher Lord. Finished. It is like the people of Shu'aib who told them, you either follow us or we will kick you out. It's the same. The same message the mushriks of Mecca told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What the Quran records for us, لِيُثْبِتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ. All what they want is to silence you and stop you from making da'wah, or to kill you. If they can't do both or one of them, they want to kick you out. That's all the conspiracies are about. Now, unfortunately, it used to be that when you are admitted in a nation that you desire, you're happy. Like people are happy to go to a freer country. People are happy to go to a place where they can make more money, better living, where they can live their way, practice their faith as they want. People are happy. In our countries today, what is the punishment of somebody who disagrees with the government? The punishment is they prevent you from exiting the country. So they know that the country has turned into a big prison, and the punishment is you stay in. That's what they do. So they are admitting that they want us to become slaves, not for Allah, but slaves for their own system, their own way of life. And what is in their own way of life? Muslim nations have produced the largest number ever of what? Political prisoners, tortured people, and what? Disease and ignorance and backwardness in every sphere of life. Plus, they have produced the largest number of total world refugees. Why? Because the focus is only to make an army or a police force that is only enough to protect the regime, but never enough to protect the nation. So the objective now has been that I, as a pharaoh, all what I want is to set up a regime and protect the regime and those who believe in my regime and follow my system and do whatever I want with the rest. So Pharaoh used to do the same thing. قَالَ سَنُقَتِّلُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَنَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ وَإِنَّا فَوْقَهُمْ قَاهِرُونَ. We will kill their children and will enslave their women, and we have the power to do anything with these guys. So they are only doing what they are doing because they have the power. And some Muslims are saying, things are not clear in our head. We don't really understand who's right and who's wrong. Well, no, you better believe it. Allah is right and everybody else is wrong. And anyone who follows Allah is right, and anyone who follows these types of tyrants and despots, they are wrong. They are wrong believing in them, they are wrong following them, and they are lying when they say, we don't understand who's right and who's wrong. Your conscience should tell you who's right and who's wrong. Whether it is Burkina Faso or Egypt or Libya or anywhere else in these nations where the military wants to control the nation. And they are making false claims. They are saying that the military is the most stable institution. But there is no safety. If there is no safety, how could the military claim to have any power or any system or any stability? Stability of what? Oh, they are referring to the stability of their institution, their regime, their control over resources, over the media, the judiciary, the police force, the intelligence apparatuses, and the economy. So they are stable. Their upper echelon of leaders in those military forces are stable. Why is it whenever there is a change that the military takes over? Because they have the guns. And then anyone who stands up for them, for their brute force and brutality, they say, you are a terrorist. Who has the guns? Who's killing? They are, but they are telling the young youth who only go out in the streets with their voices. They don't want even to see them or hear them. So they start killing them on daily basis. In what deen is this? Except self-worship. It is in the Pharaonic deen. It is in the Pharaonic deen, the deen of Pharaoh, that the police force, the military, is only working to protect the regime, not the people. So you see people in bad situations, and the military doesn't run to save them, but they run to manipulate their calamities, to manipulate their misery, and claim after things have been destroyed and all of that, that we are here to save you, we are here to protect you, we'll give you some money, some compensation to bypass your calamity. Recently, the Egyptian military, unfortunately, has gone out of his way to destroy an entire community, bombing and shelling rockets at homes in Sinai. Who benefits from that? It is the self-worship. It is not the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we worship Allah, we would never act like tyrants. If we worship Allah, we would never use force except according to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, I am told we have to conclude early today, so I'm not going to take longer. But the point I want you to go home with is this central question. Does Islam have a say in how we live? Is Islam a way of life or just a religion of prayer and supplication? Islam, as introduced by Prophet Yusuf, he says that I followed the faith of my father and grandfather and great-grandfather, Ibrahim wa Ishaq wa Yaqub. مَا كَانَ لَنَا أَن نُشْرِكَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. It wouldn't be fitting for us to associate any partner with Allah. Not a human, not a regime, not an apparatus, not a nation, not a flag, nothing. And then he says, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. Governance, rulings, judgments are reserved exclusively for Allah. It is not for anyone to control how you think, how you live, how you worship, whether you believe or not. It is all between you and Allah. But the society as a whole has to live within the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it is a society of Muslims, it is expected to live according to the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide our hearts to understand our deen and to give it our commitment and to give it our discipline and to give it our practice. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina istafa wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lah. وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وبعد. The ayat of Surah Al-Ma'idah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the revelation of the Torah, the Injil, and the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the Torah has been sent as light and guidance, and it is supposed to be used by the religious leaders, rabbis and Qurayts and ministers and priests, to judge between people. To judge between people. And then it mentions the ayah I mentioned earlier about tooth for a tooth, an eye for an eye, and so on and so forth. And at the end it says, ومن لم يحكم بما أنزل الله فأولئك هم الكافرون. Those who do not judge and live by the rules of Allah, they are kafir. They have rejected their faith. This is serious. Then follows, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Those are the wrongdoers, the unjust ones. Then come the ayat about the Christians, about the Injil given to Isa as mercy and guidance to mankind and so on and so forth. And then it says, وَلْيَحْكُمْ أَهْلُ الْإِنْجِيلِ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ. Let the people who follow the Injil rule by and judge by what they received in the Injil, what Allah has sent in the Injil, which gives security for people of the book to live according to their faith even under an Islamic state. I'm not talking about Daesh or anybody, I'm talking about the real Islamic state. So when the Quran itself secures them to judge by their own book in matters that are not included in public law that the society as a whole has to live by, then what more freedom? Why are they claiming to fear Islam when their worship places are protected, their institutions are protected, their family law is fully implemented by their own priests and ministers? Why are they claiming fear? Why is this phobia? Why is this phobia? Fear from Islam. It is artificial. It is not founded in real study. And they know it. It is not that they don't. They do know it. But unfortunately, we have to speak up. But to speak up, we have to be willing to follow on the footsteps of prophets and their followers, which means to take the risk of the backlash of declaring that we are Muslims and we have to speak up. And we want to practice our faith. We don't want to impose it on anybody, but we don't want anybody to impose the liberal version or secular version of what Islam is or is not. We want Islam that came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Islam of the Quran and the Islam of the Sunnah. That is all what we know. But we should speak up. We should teach it to our neighbors. So long as we conceal it and hide it, people wouldn't know. What are you standing really for? Then it goes on to the Prophet ﷺ to tell him, وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَمُهَيْمِنًا عَلَيْهِ فَاحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ عَمَّا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ لكل جعلنا منكم شرعة ومنهاجا. O Muhammad, we've sent down the book to you, confirming the book that came before, referring to the book given to Musa and Isa, confirming the book that came before. ومهيمنا عليه, and a criterion over it, which means it is the yardstick that you use to judge what to accept or not accept from the previous revelation. But definitely, in the same surah, Allah told us that our deen is complete. So we need not to look outside of our deen for anything. But just in case somebody makes a suggestion, if it is consistent with your deen, that's okay. We can work with anybody. And this is part of the flexibilities that Islam institutes in its system. It teaches its followers to be flexible enough to work with others, but to be disciplined enough to stick to your own principles. I don't see anything wrong with that. I don't see any reason for anybody to fear a system that gives its followers flexibilities to accommodate others if what they say is not going to force the Muslim to contradict his own faith. That's all what it is. Then the ayat go down, and finally Allah asks a rhetorical question. أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ Do people just want the rule of the pre-Islamic ignorance era? Is this what they want? They want to go back to jahiliyyah? They want to go back to killing and bloodshed? In reality, if we don't follow Islam, we end up engaged in bloodshed, whether it is our blood because we are weak and we don't have the force to defend ourselves, or because we don't want to live Islam, so Allah sends forces against us to wake up and to realize that it is serious and it is hurtful, it is harmful for even our worldly interest. أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حُكْمًا لِقَوْمٍ يُقِنُونَ And who is better in ruling, in governance, in judgment, in knowledge, in wisdom than Allah? Who? Is there a human being? Is there any human institution? Is there any collective body of knowledge and power and wisdom that could come close or even be compared? There is none. So it ends up being a rhetorical question. Allah is telling us there is no wisdom and there is no knowledge. Why do we want to live by trial and error? I'm asking my liberal and secular friends. Why do we want to live by trial and error when we can live by righteousness and justice? It's a standing question. But it is a rhetorical question as well. We know the answer. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وعافنا في من عافيت وتولنا في من توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين اللهم اقض الدين عن المدينين وفرج هم المهمومين ونفس كرب المكروبين واختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة